What up, players? It's WarbossTae up in this mug. Welcome to my part two, my final part of how to paint a scribe servitor. This is the servitor that comes with the quartermaster and retinue kit from Forge World for the Death Corps of Krieg. And we finished him up. We painted up all of his parchment seals. We faded them, and I'll be showing you in another video how to do faded parchment, but that's how he looks, and I'm really happy with it. This is all the colors you need for this video. We've got Karak Stone, Bugman's Glow, Gehenna's Gold, Lead Belcher, right there, Rakarth Flesh, Corn Red, Doomble Brown, and the only wash we're using is a little bit of Agrax Earthshade. We're not even really using it except to touch up some areas. Now you can see the star of the Scribe Servitor video series. It's a Micron Arts 0.005 Micron pen in black. So there we go. Thumbs up and let's get this baby going. When we last left off, our servitor guy was drying out, was chilling, drying out from his shades. So the first thing I wanted to do was highlight the skin with a mixture of Bugman's Glow and Karak Stone. You're going to be using 50-50, half and half. And the reason why we do this instead of like Cadian Flesh Tone or something else like that is that it's easier when you build up from a base coat into your new color. So gradually adding in, it's easier to see the transitions. And so because we used Bugman's Glow in the last video to paint the skin, and then we did some shading with Raglan Flesh Shade, using Bugman's Glow mixed with another color will be a smoother transition for the highlight, which is kind of what I wanted. And Karak Stone, I chose Karak Stone because it's a nice pale beige color. It's a good highlight for Bugman's Glow, and it's just a little bit, because of how I mixed it, half and half, you do 50% Bugman's Glow, 50% Karak Stone, it just came out a little bit pale. There's a little bit of paleness to it, which is kind of what I wanted to show, that this guy's skin is either getting, he's maybe getting a little bit old and the skin is stretching out, or it's just a little bit unhealthy. So next, for the final highlights, we're using Ushabti Bone. Oh, I'm sorry, I don't think I put this up in the lineup in the beginning of the video, but Ushabti Bone is going to be your final highlight. What I'm doing off camera right now is I'm mixing it into the wet palette and thinning it down so that it'll be really easy to control. Thinning down your paints on a wet palette gives you much better brush control than if you're using it straight out of the pot. Straight out of the pot, paints tend to be very thick and they clump up, and when you paint them on a model, there's an obvious blob of paint which disappears when you thin the paint down, and then you only use it on the tip of your model of your brush when you're painting. You can see I'm continuing to work on the base, highlighting the Steel Legion Drab with Karak Stone. Okay, WarbossTae Green is next. Thumbs up for the best color in the Games Workshop range. And I'm going to forgive them for not printing it correctly. There should be a T-A-E at the end of that Warboss on the paint pot, but that's okay. So we're just using the tip of our brush to dot the little end of the lenses there. We want to leave as much of the black in the outline as possible. Alright, Corn Red. Now we're going to highlight the robe. And when highlighting lots of heavy folds of cloth like this, one of the techniques that I like to use is following the line of the cloth. And what that means is you see the arm going down, so I will paint in short diagonal strokes going from the top to the bottom. Because what that does is it puts most of the, or more of the paint on the top part while you're painting, and then the paint kind of thins down towards the bottom so you can show a smoother transition. You can really work with the shadows, and it's a simple technique that I wasn't able to grasp. Like, I just wanted to, you know, paint these highlights on originally when I first started to learn about highlighting, but most of the videos that I followed, a lot of the professional painters that I talked to said that if you want to do good highlighting, you do a series of short strokes when you're painting cloth, and you kind of stay in the same direction instead of doing like diagonal and then horizontal and then vertical paint strokes. You try to follow the fall of the cloth. Here we're getting to the hood, putting most of the color or the highlight onto the front or in the top, and then spreading it out and kind of brushing it in a little bit more, unevenly as we go into the shadows, so that we leave that darker color in the shadows there. Next, we're going to use Rackarth Flesh, and we are going to be, I believe, highlighting up all of the parchment. So when you're highlighting back up to the original base color, and that what that means is that in part one we painted the parchment Rackarth Flesh, then we shaded it down with Agarx Earthshade. When you're highlighting it back up, anytime you start doing any kind of highlighting, it's safer to go with the original color and then really lightly touch up the higher areas. The trick is you want to leave as much of the previous color or the shading color in the shadows and to give it contrast and depth, but at the same time you want to put enough of this highlight color that you start to see a little bit more of a change in the color in the raised areas. So when painting parchment, especially long strips of parchment like this, I like to paint horizontally, because then when you see the paint strokes from the front, it kind of looks more like the folds in a parchment roll when you roll it up and you roll it out. If I was painting straight up and down, then you wouldn't have that effect, and it wouldn't make it look as realistic. So you can see I'm going from the inside out, from the outside in. As long as you get these horizontal brush strokes, it doesn't really matter. I think it really depends on how comfortable you are holding it. Holding the model at an angle where you can get to it with your paintbrush. So now I'm eyeing out these extra rolls of parchment on his side there, and I'm just painting the front. Again, starting from the center out. I tend to like going from the center out, I think. He said just before he actually started painting from the outside in. Alright, so I can tell now that I'm starting to get a little bit, I don't want to say sloppy, but some of the Rackarth Flesh is staying on the model and kind of seeping into the cracks and the folds between the paper. So you can see right there what I'm doing is I'm taking some Agarx Earthshade and I'm just putting some on the tip of my brush, and I'm just very, very gently pulling it into the shadows, finding the shadows, and really gently putting it down in there so that when it dries, it doesn't look like I was painting a highlight color. And that highlight color kind of mixed up messed up the paint job. Hey, I'm really excited, you guys, because starting in the new year, my commission painting business, WarbossTae Studios, is going to go full steam ahead. Right now, I'm just doing some small private contracts and commissions to get set for it. I'm really, really excited about it. My lady boss and I are trying to figure out how to do all the, you know, accounting and bookkeeping and everything. So I'm going to be reaching out to some of my friends out there who I know are commission painters, and just try to see, you know, what are the best practices? How do I keep myself safe and covered and all of that? So stay tuned for that, because that's going to be pretty exciting. And just a lot of brand new things in the new year that we're thinking of doing to invigorate the channel, bring in new viewers, and keep all of you, you veteran longbeards who've been following my work for a long time, how to keep all of you happy.
Maybe have more Igor and Friends episodes.
Lead Belcher next. I'll think about that, Igor. And Lead Belcher, you'll notice that I only really use it for two things. And the first one is base coating, and the second is highlighting those silver pieces of the model. This time, however, I did miss the little studs that are holding, or the rivets that are holding the parchment to the back apparatus there, so I just painted those in. And now what I'm doing is I'm just going over what I shaded down with Agrax Earthshade. Just going over lightly over the top of it. You can have that dried Agrax Earthshade in the shadows, but it really is best if you just kind of paint on that Lead Belcher and leave those shadows. So my girl and I went into Burlingame the other day, and we had liquid nitrogen ice cream. And I was like, what is this? It's like a science experiment mixed with ice cream, and it's just so cool. It's colder and smoother than regular ice cream. If you have a chance, if you know there's a liquid nitrogen ice cream parlor in your neck of the woods, then I suggest going to it because it's really good. I was just thinking about it right now, looking at this guy. I don't know why. What about this model made me think about ice cream? Anyways, Gehenna's Gold is the highlight we're going to use for the gold Imperial Eagle. Okay, I've got my Micron Arts Pen 0.005 in black. Now is the fun part. I think this part is going to take the majority, or at least 50% of the rest of the video. And it's just me writing straight lines. And I wish there was a technique I could teach you guys on how to do this. All I can say is, if you want the best results, you've got to be patient. And you've got to get in as close as possible. You do not want... A lot of times I see this mistake that painters make when doing parchment like this is that they leave lots of space between each written line, because our eyes are, you know, accustomed to seeing things bigger and properly formatted and stuff. But when you're getting right down to it and you're doing these lists, you'll hide the fact that you're not actually writing words better, and you will not cause the eye to focus on the writing, but instead to take in the model as a whole cohesive thing if you make the space between your lines really as short as possible. Follow the, I guess just the shape of the scroll or the parchment. If your model is holding a sheet of parchment that is, like, what's a good example? If you got, for example, a sheet of parchment or something that the guy is covering and using as a tabard, right? Lots of Space Marines have this weird parchment that's just hanging off the front, covering up their junk and stuff, and people will paint script inside. If you look on anyone, I guess, who's not a professional painter, or most people who just kind of do it for fun and don't really think about the writing, you'll notice that the squiggles are really big. These lines of squiggles are really big, and therefore, if they were really that big, size, you know, 300 font written on these tabards in real life, if they were really that big, then you would be able to make out the words. So what I do to compensate for that is you'll notice that I'm just writing as thinly as possible. I'm obviously not using a ruler, so I'm just kind of going with what I think and what I know would look best on the model. what I started doing here was making this left parchment in the shape of either a paragraph that's wrapping around a photo or statistics, who killed who, and what the final score is. And then I think at some point I was just like, you know what, you can't really see it anyways, doesn't make any sense, I'm just gonna fill it in right here. Boosh. See, if I use a paintbrush and I dip the tip of it in water and I try to get a good control of my brush so that I could paint these parchment papers, I might have been able to do it, who knows, you know, never say never, but I've just found ever since I started using this pen that all other times are gonna I'm gonna use it. Writing. And these, this parchment here hanging down the back, it's a little bit harder to get to because, I'm sorry, so fuzzy right now, but the one hanging down to the left is kind of at an angle. Anytime you're painting something at an angle, like, I mean specifically painting lines of script down a sheet of fabric or parchment where the sheet itself is at an angle or it's kind of bends or folds, some of the banners are really bad at this. You have to figure what the design would look like if it was straight, flat, straightened out, perfectly good, like hanging on a wall, and then you have to imagine it folding, kind of caving in on itself, and adjust your design accordingly. And that's not as easy to do. So like here, this front parchment that I'm kind of scribbling over, I think I get some of these lines a little bit crooked because I'm trying to write according to what I think the scroll is going to look like when it's all finished, and at the same time do it correctly and have some sort of a cohesive look to it. Thank you. And here we're painting up the sheet of parchment here that's in the center. And again, it's at a little bit of a weird angle. It's not as subtle as the angle of the parchment right below it. So because it's a little bit more off to the side, I'm trying to figure out how to get the lines straight according to the paper. And now when I'm writing in the script for these top two sheets of parchment, I'm just gonna have to rewire my brain so that it's going like almost straight up and down. And this one on the left side of the camera screen is almost perfectly straight up and down. So all of these angles of the script are gonna be different, and if you just kind of rush through them, the danger is if you just rush through these that you have a bunch of lines of script that are all kind of similar to each other, even though the parchment that it's written on is at a different angle. And you don't want that, because then it just ruins the look of your writing. And the last two pieces are up here. So there you go, all of the writing is done. It was very tedious, it's a very long process, but you want to go through with it. Doombo Brown. You know what, if at a certain point, things like that that I think are kind of, you know, just take a long time and they're kind of tedious, I just kind of shut my brain off. I listen to podcasts, I listen to other YouTube channels, and it helps it pass the time, and then it becomes almost meditative. So what I'm doing now is I'm putting Doombo Brown onto various places. And the reason why I'm doing this is because I'm trying to make, like, you know how they have chapter breaks in those olden times books where the first letter of the new chapter is contained within like a design. It's kind of what I decided to do. It kind of makes the papers a little bit less monotonous and more interesting, and then it adds a little bit of color as well. And that's not a bad thing. So the tricky thing is that you want to paint little squares to match the little tiles of the artwork that we are kind of referencing. And so I'm putting a little bit of paint on the tip of my brush, and when I'm painting it onto the model, I'm trying to do like one or two little little pressings of the paint down. But if you get weird looking designs, you take a look at this. I'm fixing it up with rack art flesh now. If it does not look like a square, you just go back over with your highlight color, in this case rack art flesh, and then you clean up the edges, because there's no mistake that cannot be retouched up, painted over, or fixed with a little bit of the color that you had underneath. Okay, now what we're going to do is we're going to mix rack art flesh and Lamian medium. Bad idea. Do not do that. Okay, this is my mistake that I made. Do not do this. What ended up happening was the Lamian medium actually it thinned down the rack art flesh, but then when I painted it over the faded part to make the parchment look faded, what the Lamian medium did was blur and smear the Micron Arts ink. It could have been because I didn't give it enough time to dry, but I would actually rather, if I were going to go back to make the parchment look faded, I would not use Lamian medium. I would take my rack art flesh and I would water it down with just plain old water to make it a glaze. I'd make sure that the Micron Arts ink, the Micron pen ink, had a lot of time to dry, and then when I painted over the rack art flesh as a glaze, it would go on a lot easier. So you're going to notice while I'm painting it on that at the bottom the ink starts to smear, and so I'm trying to like push it off. Yeah, what is this? But yeah, just a little lesson that I learned. All right, thanks for watching, everybody. I'm going to show you the finished video right now, or the finished look at the model while I sign off. If you want to check out my I'm going to do a take five with how to fade the parchment even more, but that's the faded parchment look all around the model. Great model to paint. I'm really happy I got to do it. Thanks for watching. Latest players!